This video was originally presented in April 2021 as a part of the Urban Forest Initiative TreeCATs workshop. This workshop introduces college students to multiple urban and community forestry topics, including tree care, social engagement, and urban design, and aims to elevate students' awareness of the value of trees in our communities and how to care for them. This presentation focuses on skills to identify trees that are commonly found in the urban landscapes of the South Central United States. Robert Paratley is a curator of the University of Kentucky Herbarium and an instructor in the Department of Forestry and Natural Resources. The Urban Forest Initiative team is appreciative of his contribution to the workshop and for allowing us to share his presentation more widely.
So what I'm going to do in this time slot is go through several groups of hopefully easily recognizable plants with a particular emphasis on park, cemetery, yard, and street trees. That was my thinking here. So we're going to look at some of these groups of trees. Again, most of them are popular in our human scapes. So we're going to start with maples, something that most of you recognize. And I'm starting with a tree that's not particularly my favorite, silver maple. It's an extremely commonly planted tree still. It has some problems in urban settings, including getting into septic systems and brittleness. It breaks in wind damage very easily. But here's a place to start. And what's maple about this? Most of you probably recognize sort of what a maple leaf looks like. Most of them are lobed. Let me get my cursor in action here. Here's the silver maple leaf. It's lobed and it's got some small teeth on it. The jargon word for the way this leaf is constructed is palmate. And what that means is that there are usually three, sometimes five main veins coming right from the base of the leaf, as opposed to a leaf that has one main vein and obvious secondary veins coming off of it. So the maples all have this palmate construction to their leaves. And not too long from now, the silver maple and the next one I'm going to show you will already be dropping their fruit. So probably another way to know maples as a group is to look at these paired winged fruit that are called samaras that catch the wind and disperse that way. So you'll see a picture of the fruit in all of these maple pictures, but silver maple and its close cousin, red maple, which is the next slide, they flower very early, probably second, third week in March. So they're already done flowering and they waste absolutely no time producing their fruit. So here's red maple, again, closely related to silver maple. The spaces between the lobes are not quite as deep in red maple. It's an extraordinarily well-used tree in our landscapes, probably overused in some ways. It's very similar to silver maple. The bark is not quite as rough, but very similar. Here's a picture of its flowers. Again, they're long gone. They're very attractive. They're small, but they're very attractive. And again, red maple is already producing and they're ready to drop practically the paired samaras that they've got. The most commercially important of my trio of maples to show you is sugar maple, an important timber tree, and also still a very popular street tree, which has its problems, but still it's a very attractive tree. It's probably about to flower. Again, the flowers you have to look closely at to study them. They're pretty small. There is the maple leaf. It looks like the flag of Canada, actually. Again, the palmate construction. And a little bit later on, late spring, it'll be producing these paired winged fruit. So those are the maples that I'm going to show you. The key is the construction of the leaf, I think, and the fruit that they'll be producing. And you can look at slides like this, and I think they're a pretty good comparison of the three maples that I just showed you, and you can see their leaves side by side, and you can make the comparisons. And then I threw in a fourth one, which is also commonly planted, and many people don't really even distinguish it from sugar maple or have a hard time knowing the difference. In fact, some people think that they're the same species or offshoots of the same species. It's called black maple, and it looks a lot like sugar maple with not quite as many small little lobes. Leaf is thicker, and it often has a kind of a curled look to it, and it almost looks like it's wilted, even when it's not. So those are the maples. And again, this slide might be the handiest for you, where you can look at the leaves and make the comparison. So let's look at a larger and arguably more important group of trees for our landscapes, our urban landscapes, which are oaks. And all of the ones that I've selected are native oaks. Occasionally we see European oaks planted, but most of the time native oaks are selected. So oaks often are known by, of course, their acorns, and most of the pictures that I'm going to show you will have acorns, and you can use acorns to some extent to tell the difference among the different oaks. Also, most of them, but not all of them, have lobed leaves like this. And the construction of an oak leaf is different from the construction of a maple leaf. And this is an example of what we call pinnate construction, where there's a main axis or a main vein, and then more or less angled or perpendicular to the main vein come the veins, the secondary veins, and the lobes. Again, most of our oaks have lobed leaves, but you'll see at the end, a few of them do not. So oaks, very important, have to start with white oak, not the most commonly selected oak in urban landscapes, but it's a good place to start. It's one of the most important, commercially important oaks, and it has rounded lobes, and many of you probably are quite familiar with white oak. It has this kind of platy, chalky gray bark, which it shows when it becomes somewhat mature. And here's a little handful of the acorns. That picture is a little bit larger than life size. And usually the white oak acorn is a little bit longer than it is wide like that, although it's quite variable. So there's white oak. In our region, bur oak is probably a more popular selection. It needs a lot of room. So you often see it in places that have a lot of space. The canopy is usually as wide as it is tall. It's got much rougher bark than white oak. And the two diagnostic features of bur oak would be the very large acorn, much larger than white oak or any of the other oaks I'm going to show you, and this kind of hairy cap. Most of the oaks have a scaly cap. And this one has scales too, but it also has this noticeable fringe. And that picture, at least on my screen, is just about life size. It's by far the largest of our native acorns of the oaks. The other diagnostic thing is this is another white oak with these rounded lobes. But in most cases, here's my cursor dancing around, the middle space, they're called sinuses, the middle space in the middle of this leaf is quite a bit deeper than the other lobes. And if I just go back to white oak, we don't see that in white oak. But here we have kind of shallow spaces, and then this one deep one in the middle. Here's a tree that I've noticed is becoming much more popular in the last 5 to 10 years. It's being selected and put in to parks and along streets in our region. It's called swamp white oak. It's certainly not common in native landscapes here. It's mostly to the west and north of Kentucky, but it is selected. It does very well in urban soils. And it too has these kind of rounded lobes to it, not more than white oak or bur oak. And what else can I say about it? The two most telling things about swamp white oak, one of them is in the limbs, and it has what's called, okay, the fancy word is exfoliating. And all that means, that fancy word means that the bark peels away, almost like a birch. And that's very unusual in an oak. So swamp white oak has this kind of peely, papery bark on some of its limbs. And the other, what I call a tell for swamp white oak, is when it produces acorns, it does something that none of our other native oaks do, and that it puts its acorns on this long stalk. Most acorns are held very close to the twig that bears them with a very, very short stalk. But here in swamp white oak, it dangles them, and those stalks can be 2 to 3 or even 4 inches long. So that's another tell or a real solid indicator for swamp white oak. And again, there's more and more of this in our urban landscapes with good reason. It seems to do pretty well. So here is a review slide. Again, if you want to go back and really try to learn some of this, you can see the leaves placed side by side on the slide. And I also snuck in another member of the white oaks, which is chinquapin oak, a limestone loving oak that's also fairly popular in our humanized landscapes. The tell with chinquapin oak, if you look closely at the leaves, I've circled it in these little red circles, they have these little glands or little tiny teeth. They're actually glands on those teeth. And the other oaks don't have anything like that. But you have to look kind of closely. You have to look kind of closely at chinquapin oak to tell the difference. Its bark is pretty similar to most of these other oaks as well. So those are some white oaks. And here's a slide, maybe I should have put this first, that shows the difference between the white oaks, which I've just showed you, and the red oaks, which I'm gonna show you in a moment. And basically the key difference in the leaves is that the red oaks along the tips of all of their lobes have what we call bristle tips, which are these little stiff, wiry little hairs on them. And the white oaks never have that. So the chinquapin oak and the bur oak and the white oak that I just showed you will not have those. But all of these red oaks that I'm going to show you now will have that in the leaves. There's also a difference in the acorns as well, which I don't show you here. The red oaks take 2 years to mature their acorns, and the white oaks can accomplish the same feat in 1 year. So here are, I think I've got 3, maybe 4 red oaks. And the most common in our landscapes is pin oak, besieged by a bacterial scorch, but still popular. It kind of thrives in our urban environments because its natural environment is heavy, compacted clay soils in wetter places. So it does very well, but it is it does have problems with bacterial disease. It's got fairly smooth bark, as you can see on the left here. If people don't prune the lower branches, and most people do, the lower branches will weep, meaning they'll kind of not be pressed upward, but they'll be kind of pointed downward. That's kind of something to look for. The pin oak leaf is small compared to some of the other red oaks, and it only has, as you can see, basically 5, maybe 6 lobes to it, and some of the other red oaks have more. The acorn is kind of squashed. It's smaller, and it's kind of compacted a little bit. So that's pin oak, probably the most commonly planted oak in Lexington as a street tree. Northern red oak is another popular selection that you find in our parks, in our urban areas. It's my personal favorite. It's a majestic and gorgeous tree in its natural environment in our rich woods all throughout Kentucky. One of the things that is noticeable about northern red oak is this kind of streaking in the mature bark, which it doesn't always show that much of when it's planted in an urban area, but certainly when you get out into the woods, you see this alternating light and dark pattern. It's very striking, and it makes it an even more handsome tree, in my opinion. Here's the leaf with many more lobes, and it's kind of a robust leaf. It's kind of a large one. Here's two versions of it. There, the acorn is larger, and the nut itself is kind of stout, and it almost looks like it doesn't even fit in the cap that holds it there. It's kind of plump there. So that's northern red oak. And again, we're going to continue to move forward just to see how far we can get with this. Okay, here's the two that I just showed you. This is a review slide. And I sneak in a third, which is Schumard oak, which is also quite commonly used in our region. It likes a pretty rich soil. So limestone derived soils is quite to its liking. It also grows in bottomlands. And it's often confused with northern red oak because it's majestic and straight growing like northern red oak is. It has the alternating streaking in the bark, in the mature bark, and its leaf is about the same size as northern red oak, but you can see a difference here in that the spaces or the sinuses between these lobes is quite a bit deeper and narrower than in northern red oak. And that's really the best way to tell the difference. They're used very similarly in our landscapes. Both of them are extremely handsome trees. So here's an oak that's also quite commonly used, and you might not even recognize it as an oak because it doesn't have lobed leaves the way the white oaks and the red oaks that I showed you. But when it fruits, it tips its hand. It shows us it's a small acorn, but certainly it's an acorn producer. Excuse me. And if you start to get an eye for what willow oak and some of its close cousins look like, you can start to see that it actually does look and has very similar bark to some of the other red oaks as well. It holds its branches very similarly. And sometimes the branches weep the way pin oak's branches weep. And of course it produces acorns, so you know. So why is it a red oak, right? Well, it has one and only one bristle tip. And that's right, you can't see it in this slide, but right at the tip of these almost bamboo-like leaves. Very handsome foliage, and it's probably one of the reasons why it's commonly planted in our landscapes. But it does have one bristle tip, whereas pin oak and northern red oak and Schumard oak would have one on every lobe. Okay, here are two cousins that you occasionally see that are closely related to willow oak. And in the winter, they look very similar. They have very similar acorns to willow oak. One's called shingle oak. The other is called water oak. And you occasionally see these in our landscapes as well. Although willow oak, to my experience, is the most commonly used of these three. But I like all three of them. And all three of them have a bristle tip, like a good card-carrying red oak. All right. We're done with the oaks. That's our biggest unit. This next grouping is also a natural grouping. They're all in the same family. It's called the rose family, although I'm not showing you any roses. I'm showing you cherries and apples and pears and serviceberry. So all of those are closely related, okay? And the first contender here, very, very popular, very common in our central Kentucky region, is black cherry. In fact, it's sometimes even weedy in our region a little bit, but it's also selected as an urban and suburban street tree as well. It seems to do pretty well. When it's young, it has this dark bark with these horizontal streaks in them. As it gets older, it gets this dark color to it, and it becomes kind of chippy and flaky. and still, if you look closely, you can see those horizontal streaks in it. And sometimes that's all you need to identify black cherry, is just looking at that dark, chippy bark. But here are the leaves. They are alternate on the branch. They're kind of glossy, smooth, and long-tipped. And if you get up close and personal with black cherry or any cherry or any plum, which is in the same genus, Prunus, if you get up close and personal with the leaves of cherries and plums, and you are observant and you know what you're looking for, you can see at the base of the leaf blade, two small glands. And that is a good, if you can see it, that's a good indicator for the cherries and plums. And again, if you see a low hanging branch or leaves on the ground, you can pick one up and you can see those little glands there. And these other things, the apples and the service berries and really any other tree that has a leaf that kind of looks like a cherry, it's not gonna have these little glands to it. Okay, I didn't have a picture of the flower. I ran out of room on this slide, but you'll see some pictures in the other members of the rose family. And cherries have flowers that are pretty similar. The black cherry isn't quite flowering yet, but some of its ornamental cousins, which I believe are in the next slide, are already flowering. And by early summer, they will be producing, well, what do you think? Cherries, much smaller than store-bought cherries and not as tasty, but the birds love them. So that's black cherry. Here are some of its exotic and ornamental and very showy cousins. All of these will have the little glands as well. Most of these are either flowering now or they have already flowered, and that like the last few flowers are up on the tree. These are much shorter, smaller trees than the black cherry. These come from Asia. These that we've got here, they will, yes, produce cherries too. And they have the same kind of bark that black cherry has with these streaks in the bark. So these are some ornamental cherries that are very popularly planted as well. I hesitated to put this tree in, but it is so popular. It's almost insipidly popular in some of the newer neighborhoods. It's, I guess, easy to get a hold of. It's probably inexpensive, and it's planted readily throughout suburban and even urban Lexington and other cities. The problem with this, this tree, and many of you may know this, is that it has escaped from the parks and streets of our cities and suburbs, and it is now aggressively establishing itself in woodland edges and disturbed places throughout our region. So this is not a tree I would recommend, but it's here because it's so common, and it's worth recognizing if you're trying to learn some trees. It's got this glossy leaf. It does not have the glands because it's not a cherry at all. Some of them have these quite nasty thorns on them, and it is done flowering, and pretty soon it'll be producing. You're thinking, those don't actually look like pears, but they are pears. They're just not pear-shaped, and they're quite a bit smaller. And unfortunately, the birds will eat them, and they will scatter these and create more problems with the Callery or the Bradford pear. So let's leave that because I don't want to linger over it, but it is one that's found very, very commonly in our landscapes, and it's worth recognizing. Lastly, in this clan of attractive, usually small statured trees, all in the same family, are the service berries. We have one common native service berry in our forests, particularly in eastern Kentucky. But the ones that we see in our landscapes are usually ornamentals and hybrids. Some of them are hybridized with the native. What you're seeing here are probably hybrids of service berry, which is why I just put the genus name there. The way to recognize service berries, my favorite way, is to look at the narrow or the fine dark streaking in the bark. It's got a pretty light gray, smooth bark, but it does have these little fine vertical dark streaks in it, which I think are quite nice. Service berries are already done flowering, so they're easy to recognize in March when they burst into these white blossoms. And then by late spring, they're going to produce these essentially tiny little apples. They are palms, they have cores, and they are very, you probably know this, they're very good eating. So don't hesitate, because the birds like them just as much as you do, as you will. I highly recommend service berries to just grab off the tree and eat. Okay, crab apples, closely related to the commercial apple. These are also extremely common in our landscapes. They come in many different flavors or colors of flowers and fruit. And all of them have this kind of toothed apple-like leaf to them. Don't look for the glands that you saw in the cherries and plums, because they don't have them. And that's one of the handy ways of saying, what is this? But probably the handiest way is to recognize the fruit that most of them bear. And they persist throughout the season. So you can see the small crab apples late into the season as well. The next clan that I've chosen are the locusts and other legumes that we've got. We've got a number of them that we use as street trees. So here's black locust, a native tree, often found in our landscapes, often has this kind of rough and often crooked trunk to it. It has a compound leaf. What does that mean? It means that the leaf is kind of long and elaborate, and it has a kind of a complex structure to it. It has an axis to it, and it has what we call leaflets. Oops. Most, but not all, of the legume trees have these compound leaves. All of them are going to have the legume pod, which you'll start to see. Actually, some of them persist from last year. You can see them dangling on the tree, and then they'll produce new ones probably in the summertime. Black locust, when it's young, has these spines that make it very, very hard to handle or walk through, and then it loses them when it gets more mature. In, I would guess, a week or two, maybe 3 weeks, the black locust will burst into bloom, very fragrant flowers. And if you look closely at them, they will look very, very much like sweet pea flowers or bean flowers. And there's a good reason for that, because sweet peas and beans are all in the same family, the Fabaceae, the legume family, that all of this cluster of trees are members of that family. So here's honey locust, also perhaps overplanted. In its natural environment, it produces along its limbs and even on its trunk these incredible dagger-like, very dangerous thorns. But the selection that's put into our parks and streets is an unarmed version of the tree. And you see this platy bark, but it lacks the thorns, which would make it very easy to identify. Look at the leaves, and you'll see another complex leaf, compound leaves, sometimes similar to the black locust leaf, except the leaflets are narrower, and other times it has even a more complicated structure, which means it has a main axis and it has secondary axis. It's called twice pinnately compound. So look for that in honey locust. And again, by summertime, look for these large strap-like legume pods that are quite a bit larger than the legume pod of the black locust. Both of them are very, very common in our urban environments, as is Kentucky coffee tree, which loves our alkaline soils here in our region. So it's commonly planted wherever soils have a higher pH. What can we say about Kentucky coffee tree? Also an elaborate and large and doubly compound leaf. This is all one leaf here. And you can see those coming out soon. It's a little late to leaf out, but it'll be leafing out soon. Persistent from last year on the female trees will be the stout and thick legume pod, much stouter and darker than the legumes that I just showed you. Here's a winter shot showing the coarse branching of the Kentucky coffee tree. And last but not least, the rarest tree in our selections today. It's very rare in our natural forests, but very commonly used because it's handsome and it grows well in our urban settings. It's called yellowwood. Notice its Latin name. The species name is named after our very state. This also has a compound leaf. The leaflets are quite a bit stouter than in the previous two. And the leaflets are kind of alternating along the compound leaf. A little bit later on, yellowwood will also burst into flower and in a with a pea-like flower, as you can see. And there's its legume pod as well. And last but not least, the star of probably last week and this week and hopefully next week as well, very much calling attention to itself all over our landscapes, is Eastern Redbud. Eastern Redbud did not read the operator's manual for legume trees. It has a simple and heart-shaped leaf, nothing elaborate like we saw in the last three. I'm not quite sure why that happened. This is a much smaller tree than most of the others. It's not much bigger than a crabapple. And most of you are familiar with it, particularly right now, because it's in full flower. And there's its legume as well. All right. Also flowering now, and this has nothing to do with the legumes. I just put this in because people associate it with Eastern Redbud because they both flower at approximately the same time. Redbud's a little earlier, but they overlap quite a bit, and they both are calling attention to themselves right now as we speak. This is flowering dogwood, and probably you're all familiar with it. It's also a small stature tree with this, what we call alligator hide or reptile skin bark. There's its leaf with these veins that curve towards the margin. Later on, it'll produce clusters of red drupes. And you're all probably familiar with what you think are dogwood flowers, but actually are four white, beautiful, modified leaves. And if you look closely, if you stick your nose into the center of this, you will see a cluster of maybe a dozen or more true flowers. That's where the pollinators are actually going to go. These brack leaves, these white brack leaves, are just they're like the billboard bringing in insects. But the visitation, the nectary discs and all of that are in the center there with these tiny little yellow flowers. Let's show you tulip poplar and its close cousins, the magnolias, and then I'll stop. This is called, it has several names. People call it yellow poplar, tulip tree. Tulip poplar is my favorite name. If you're fancy and scholarly, you call it Liriodendron tulipifera. It will be flowering very soon. A large, gaudy, very showy flower with lots of parts to it. That's how it connects to the magnolias. It's in the same family with the magnolias. Its leaf is unmistakable. It has lobes like a maple or an oak that we looked at earlier. But what we've got here is that we lack the center or the terminal lobe there. It only has four lobes, and it makes it one of the easiest leaves to recognize and to identify. Later in the season, it's going to produce this cluster of samaras or winged fruit. Some of them may still be, they're opened up, but they may still be on the tree before it completely leaves out. Beautiful straight trunk, fast growing, needs a lot of space, but popular in our landscapes. So let's just look briefly at its cousins. This one is not native to Kentucky, but it's popularly planted here. It's native to the deeper south than here. It's an evergreen magnolia, and most of you are probably familiar with it. By May, it will be bursting into these enormous and gaudy and very attractive magnolia flowers, not that different in many ways from the many-parted attractive flower of tulip poplar, not that different. And here is how it goes into fruit. It's got this fruit cluster, and these are not fruit, these red guys. Those are actually seeds that attract birds to disperse them. So there's an evergreen magnolia. And here I just put a slide of some of the ornamentals from Eurasia that that are coming into flower, the star magnolia and the saucer magnolia. And down in the lower left is one of my favorites. It's native to the south and barely comes into Kentucky. It's called the Sweet Bay Magnolia, with a very similar magnolia flower, but much smaller than the southern magnolia.
This completes part one of this two-part tree identification presentation. Please check back soon for the second half of this presentation. Thank you.